They may not know it, but these sons and daughters of California almost all share a common musical heritage, a heritage that has its origins in countries far removed from the razzmatazz of downtown San Francisco. It's a music that in its unique Scottish Highland form was said to have had upon an enemy a glorious effect. Most people only know of the Great Highland Bagpipe as an instrument played in bands or jazz or pop groups. Yet it's the bagpipe's ancient solo music called pibroch that's increasingly attracting worldwide interest.
The weather mostly fair in downtown San Francisco.
Pibroch reached its peak in its native Scotland in the 17th century. It may even have inspired more modern composers like Dvorak. Yet it's the original ethnic music that men like Ed Stevenson prefer to study. Ed's a motel owner from Oregon. He happens to be a first-generation immigrant from Scotland, but most of his fellow enthusiasts who flock to the dozens of piping schools that are run each summer all over the United States and Canada can have no possible motives of cultural nostalgia to spur them on. Ed's course takes place at the Santa Cruz campus of the University of California. Ed'll be here for 2 weeks of pretty intensive study and practice under the guidance of three of the top instructors from Scotland who come every year specially for this course. Not all Ed's time will be devoted to learning new pibroch tunes. Brushing up on the basic techniques on the practice chanter is essential too. Chanter is an essential aid for teaching and practice. You can stop and start easily, which you can't with a full set of pipes. The Santa Cruz campus is a bizarre enough setting for a bagpipe school in any circumstances. It's more so when you're sharing it with a conference on neural linguistics, whatever that is.
Right on down.
The heat, too, is 90 in the shade, hardly conducive to blowing pipes.
I feel a very special energy in the air.
I hear a special energy.
If we look some more at the first line of the doubling, where there's that rhythmic thing, the first three notes, the third note there.
The first line. All right, we'll do the first line again. I'll play the first line and come in on the repeat.
Ronnie Laurie was the pipe major of the Glasgow Police. He's been teaching here for several years. Both he and the course director, Seamus McNeil, reject the oft-held view that without a Gaelic background, you can't play pibroch.
All Americans, no matter what their ethnic background, unless they're really American Indians, had pipers somewhere in their ancestry and back in the Middle Ages. So there's no reason why the Scots should feel that, you know, bagpipes belong to them more than to anybody else. So what anybody sort of is attracted by the sound of the bagpipe, the only instrument available to learn is the Highland bagpipe, and this is why they do it. They can't all be champions, but they can play well enough to satisfy themselves. And the proof of the pudding is, you see, there are some pipers who, not in America yet, but in Canada, who have only learned piping at summer schools and they have won top prizes in Scotland.
What's happened in Los Angeles in the dry weather, every one of my stocks were loose and I had to retie it. And now
the bagpipe is a very sensitive instrument. The bag can get too dry or too damp, as can the reeds. There's one in each of the three drones that go over the piper's shoulder and a fourth in the chanter. Knowing how to look after and tune his instrument are essential skills for any piper.
Double Bs?
We always, of course, try to teach them some pibroch, and that stimulates interest. But they hear Pembroke in other places, you know, in their own competitions, and it's amazing the number of people who sort of think this is the music they want to play. And so the middle-aged man who starts to learn to play, he wants to do something which will really fulfill him when he's playing. And he can learn to play Pembroke sooner than he can learn to play hard competition marches, suspects, and reels.
Okay, double S, one, two.
By leaning on the chisel rather delicately and pressing in a scooping action at the end, you hopefully will not buckle the tail.
The attraction of Pembroke seems to know no bounds. The students here range from the very young to the quite old, from experienced pipers new to Pembroke to complete beginners, from American citizens with vague Celtic backgrounds to a Japanese engineering student all the way from Tokyo.
At first the sound will be a stifled squeak. Finally, this is the sound you want.
The music itself is very attractive from a musicology standpoint in that it's in a progressive style. The melody progresses from a very simple to more complex and more complex and more complex and different. And it's very interesting and different from that standpoint than a lot of the music that a musician runs into.
Yo and hey and che and ho and
right, that's the second variation. But let's start off here by playing the ground over. Now, those of you who have it memorized should look here and play it. But if you feel like singing it instead of playing it, you can do that. All right? One, two.
Seamus McNeill is using cantharach. Like the practice chanter, cantharach, in Gaelic it means singing, is a teaching device. And once, before scores existed, it was the only way of passing on a pibroch from master to pupil. Pibroch has a definite form, though no set rhythm. It starts by stating a simple theme, builds on it with variations of increasing complexity, and returns to the theme.
On with the second line.
Mary Allwood's a product of summer schools herself. Good enough, Seamus thinks, to teach Pembroke here. But people like these make Colonel David Murray, a leading authority on Pembroke, excited by their interest, but apprehensive about where it'll lead.
Certainly there are going to be more and more people playing Pembroke. All these young people are going to grow up and they're going to play the music and they're going to pass it on to their children. On the other hand, there is a grave danger that it will be played exactly off the printed page. And as we get further away from the sound of the waves and the wind and the heather, then I think they'll get further away from the actual essence and the spirit of the music.
These children on the island of Skye couldn't be closer to their heritage. Katrina MacDonald is telling them a story in Gaelic about the MacCrimmons.
Patrick Moore, ba ochner chlonia eke, agus ba sich sechner you, as an ulielna.
From roughly 15 to 1800, the MacCrimmons are reckoned to have been the finest players and teachers of Pembroke and the greatest composers of all time. The story is about one of the most famous Pembroke tunes, The Lament for the Children. Patrick Moore MacCrimmon composed it in memory of seven of his eight children who died around 1645 of a fever brought by a visiting ship. The children are buried here. Mystery surrounds the MacCrimmons themselves. They're known to have held these lands at Borrareg rent-free from the chiefs of the MacLeods in return for their services as pipers. As pipers of today come from all over the world to pay homage at their cairn, so it's known that pipers then came from all over Scotland to spend perhaps years at their college. Where do the MacCrimmons come from? Ireland says one story, Cremona in Italy another. Further mystery surrounds Pibroch itself. Where it came from and how it developed, no one really knows. Such speculation is fruitless, thinks Archie Kenneth of the Pibroch Society. He spent 30 years interpreting old tunes and transcribing them from a form of written cantharach into staff notation.
If we accept the ascriptions of the various presumed MacCrimmon tunes as being correct, if they really did compose all that they're supposed to have composed, well, obviously, we owe them a very great debt. Of course, the stories about various of these tunes are diametrically opposed in the various manuscripts. For instance, take Lament for the Children. Angus Mackay has it. This is a MacCrimmon tune. Donald MacDonald has a completely different story about it, totally different, with no indication it's a MacCrimmon tune. But does it really matter all that much? If it helps anybody to believe in any of the legends behind the tunes, well, let them continue to believe these stories. It's the music, not the thing.
By 1745, the old clan system with the chiefs as the patrons of pipers and piping was already under strain. It was in an attempt to preserve it that some Highland chiefs supported Bonnie Prince Charlie when he landed here at Moidart that summer. The uprising wasn't well planned, but the prince soon had 5,000 men and got within 130 miles of London, though he never attracted enough support to oust George II. The following April found Bonnie Prince Charlie as far from his target as Inverness. George's son, the Duke of Cumberland, was sent to confront him. And at Culloden, on the morning of the 16th of April, 1746, there took place the last battle to be fought on British soil. Five 5,000 Highlanders faced 9,000 government troops. There'd been a bitter dispute between Prince Charlie's advisers about the choice of Culloden as the battleground. His better generals complained it was ideal for the English cavalry and artillery, and far from ideal for the Highlanders' chief asset, their ferocious charge. And so it proved. It was all over in an hour. The slaughter of prisoners and wounded that followed earned Cumberland his title of butcher. On piping on Pibroch was dramatic. Though the Disarming Act that forbade the wearing of tartan throughout Scotland and the carrying of arms in the Highlands didn't specifically mention the pipes, a High Court judgment defined them as instruments of war. And so began a silence that was to last for over 35 years. Cattle stealing had practically been a way of life in the Highlands before 1745. One of the effects of Cumberland's pacification, as he called it, was to stop that and so allow the development of cattle droving. By the 1770s, tens of thousands of beasts a year were being moved down the drove roads from the Highlands to the lowland markets like Falkirk. Here at the October Sale, or Trice as it was called, many Highlanders gathered. For that reason, and because it was in the lowlands and the bagpipe could legally be played, the Highland Society of London chose Falkirk in which to hold the first known Pibroch competition in October 1781. The aim was to ensure that the art of Pibroch, forbidden for 35 years, would not die out, and to prod the government into repealing the Disarming Act. They succeeded, the act was repealed, the tartan could be worn again, and the bagpipe played. Pibroch went from strength to strength. The Highland Society of London's competition inspired other Pibroch competitions, like Oban and Inverness. Queen Victoria appointed Angus Mackay, the leading Pibroch expert of his day, as her first personal piper. Competitions are still the main forum where pipers test their skills. Prince Charles, as Lord of the Isles, was the Highland Society of London's president in its bicentenary year, so royal interest continues. Clan chiefs have long since stopped being the main patrons of piping, though Pipe Major Ronnie McCallum, as piper to the chief of the Clan Campbell, the Duke of Argyll, still plays for him each morning. Until the middle of the 18th century, though, clan chiefs or landowners were the only employers of pipers. With the raising of the Highland regiments in the aftermath of the 1745 uprising, pipers now had a choice of employer. Most of the best ones, from whom today's top pipers are proud to trace their descent by teaching, chose to remain in private service. But the army has played a considerable part in keeping Pibroch alive, Colonel Murray explains.
Also, when Pibroch playing was in the doldrums in the last century, the turn of this century, it was kept going in the army to a certain extent. A ritual Pibroch was played in the officers' mess after dinner. And I think this goes back a very, very long time. And I think up to Waterloo it was played because people wanted to listen to it. After that it became part of the mess procedure. Certainly, in my own time, woe betide the pipe major who went on too long. And the practice of cutting the pibroch short was very, very prevalent, provided he finishes up with a blaze of glory playing a crooner mark behind the colonel's chair. They didn't want it to take too long. Also, it was regarded as a bit of a distraction from the general chat around the mess table. And certainly, when I started 40 years ago, it was the custom merely to talk louder when the pipers came in. It was only in the last 20-odd years that the people have begun to listen to what's going on and appreciate it really.
The seed sown by the Highland Society of London's first pibroch competition in 1781 slowly bore fruit. They held a competition every year until 1826, then every 3 years, as by then competitions were beginning to sprout up all over Scotland. Big ones as at Oban and Inverness, or small ones like here at Glenfinnan. Most of these competitions took place as part of a Highland Games. Seamus McNeill, principal of the College of Piping in Glasgow.
At one time, the Highland Games circuit was tremendously important to the competing piper. It gave him a chance to improve his standard of playing, and it also added considerably to his financial income. Because even today, in the smallest games, the best prize that's awarded is first for Pibroch. Nowadays, however, the prizes are comparatively less, and the expenses are considerably higher. So there isn't quite the same demand from the top pipers to do this kind of thing. Although the tradition continues, and a lot of young pipers, especially those from overseas, follow the circuit and get involved in what is one of the best things of it, the camaraderie of the competing piper. They join what is generally called the Highland Mafia. The best and top pipers have started going abroad because there's more finance to be gained by going over to North America and teaching schools. And they go during July and August, which is, of course, the game season. It's also the wet season in Scotland, it seems to be. And so at Highland Games, you get very few hot, sunny days and a great many wet, rainy ones. And this makes things very difficult for the competing piper.
Everybody accepted that if you went to Glenfinnan in August, then 29 days out of 31 were going to be wet. But ours is an outdoor instrument. It's all very masculine and macho, and, you know, the kilt and the heather and all that, and you're out there playing against the breeze and calling the can to battle or lamenting the chief or something. Before the games became so commercialised, then these small outdoor competitions like Arisaig, Glenfinnan, were tremendous occasions, great fun to go to and great fun to judge.
Yes, eh? What's it?
Okay, three turns. John McDonald, Glen Cole, Don McLean, Fribble to Oban, and this is John McCall.
Competing on a wet day is misery for a piper. His hands are wet and cold, and tend to slip over the chanter, and so he never gets the satisfaction of playing up to the standard that he can. If he faces into the wind, then the fingers become even colder. If he turns his back on the wind, then the rain tends to go down the drones and eventually stop his reeds. Standard of playing goes away down, and many of the older pipers decide just to stay at home on a day like this.
Though most pipers will insist that prestige and self-fulfillment are the important factors for them when deciding to enter this competition or that, they have their views about prize money. The president of the Competing Pipers Association is Malcolm McRae, an Australian now settled in Scotland and a successful competitor himself.
I think the general feeling in relation to the level of prizes is to the effect that the principal competitions pay good prize money. We haven't actively sought to represent to promoters that they should pay higher prize money. There's a feeling, I think, that around the Highland Games circuit, the prize money is abysmally low in many respects. That the prize money at the principal indoor competitions is, I think, generally regarded as quite acceptable, quite good.
At Dunvegan Castle in Skye, followers of tradition and pursuers of excellence find a happy compromise. The Silver Chanter competition is held indoors, but in the drawing room where the chiefs of the Clan MacLeod and their clansmen listened to their hereditary pipers, the MacCrimmons, 300 or 400 years ago. Donald Bain of New Zealand has begun his tune. As befits a competition held here, all the tunes to be played are MacCrimmon compositions. The Silver Chanter is a cross between a recital and a competition. Pipers who must have won a gold medal have to be invited to play, but there are prizes. Next door, but out of earshot, Ed Nye from Canada concentrates on his final tuning. Thank you. So far, and this is its 15th year, the Silver Chanter is the only top competition not to have been won by an overseas player. At this moment, Ed Nye must feel that he needs the Silver Chanter after which the competition is named. The story goes that the fairies gave one to a young, inexperienced McCrimmon who had to stand in for his teacher.
Malcolm's sweat pouring off. How'd it go, Malcolm? Your pipes stood the heat, there?
Oh, they weren't wonderful, but they didn't sort of go from good to bad. They were just
bad to start with.
Pipe Major Angus MacDonald of the Scots Guards must be feeling confident. Normally, pipers don't know in advance the tune they're to play. Here they do. Angus has drawn the Lament for the Children. He'd won with it at the local games the day before. Next on is another pipe major, Ian Morrison of the Queen's Own Highlanders. A native Gaelic speaker from Lewis, he teaches piping to young soldiers. Commenting on his performance of the Lament for Mary MacLeod, Seamus McNeill.
This is the preliminary tuning, which all pipers indulge in, partly to get the instruments set for the piece they're going to play, but also partly to get themselves mentally adjusted, taking everything else out of their minds except the tune itself, and screwing their nerves to the pitch of being able to start into this great piece of music. Tuning is very essential because as time goes through the piece, we'll find that the drones will get a little bit warmer, a little bit wetter on the reeds, and this might change the pitch of them. And of course, that would be a minor disaster if we begin to hear little discordant sounds between the drones or between the drones and the chanter. But these pipers are very good at this. Not only do they get the instrument set to start, but they also manage to forecast what it's going to do in the 10 minutes or so that the tune will last. That's it, we're off from the tune now in the ground, which has one line repeated and then other two lines. And that's the end of the first line, and now he repeats that right through. This is the preliminary statement of the piece of music. The the first presentation of the theme, and the other variations will be built upon these notes, which he's presenting so nice and steadily for us now. Now the second line.
In fact, I almost played the whole ground again. You know, it's such a short tune, and I got to that second burl, and I thought, no, that's a bit like bravado.
Yeah.
A little bit of clipping there, but that's a style and it's quite acceptable. It's the way he prefers, obviously. And they'll probably even it out. Oh, he does the high G. Well, that's a traditional note there. Though some of the modern players take a high A to avoid the jar. That's beautiful. What a lovely change into the Toro singling. Yes, this is masterly playing. It's really right on top of it. Probably not even having to think much about it. The tune will be so well practiced if he doesn't lose the place, he's going to make a great job of it.
The other competitors are waiting tensely for the competition to end. Angus MacDonald knows he can't be high on the list, for he played a wrong note.
Gentlemen, in fifth place, Pipe Major Angus MacDonald. In fourth place, Tom Spears. In third place, Malcolm McRae. In second place, Murray Henderson. And in first place, Pipe Major Ian Morrison.
To earn a living from piping, if you're not in the army, you have to be one of a few full-time teachers like Ian McFadgen. He comes from a noted piping family and is a redoubtable competitor as well as a teacher. He didn't do himself justice at the Silver Charter this year, but in his 15 years, he's won twice and been second seven times. Each week, he teaches at six schools on the mainland and four on Skye.
Far have I travelled and much have I seen.
Children can like both. I think they can like pop music and they can like people.
With valleys of green.
The majority of pipers can play a march in a sustained reel and a slow march in a jig, but I think Pibroch is a challenge, and I think that's what attracts young children. When I came here, at first I think I had something like maybe 40 pupils. I mean, now I've got over 100 pupils, and the majority of them playing Pibroch.
All of Kintyre, all mist rolling in from the sea.
detect a good player after maybe 6 to 8 weeks. But as far as saying I could detect a good Pibroch player, I wouldn't go as early as that. I would say a couple of years before you could really tell. Usually start them off with simpler tunes and introduce people to them slowly. I don't sort of just throw big heavy tunes onto them where they're going to be sort of discouraged at an early stage. I start them off with small tunes, melodic tunes, and then build up their repertoire from there. From a teaching point of view and a playing point of view of Pibroch, I get tremendous satisfaction. It gives me wonderful pleasure to listen to a child that I've taught a tune and to hear them play the tune the way I would play it. And for myself playing Pibroch, I just find it so relaxing.
Have you not done this before? Are you not going over this variation? No. All right, well, we'll do that kind of. Well, that's very good indeed. Only one thing, this last E, you're cutting that away too much.
Over the last 20 years, there's been a great increase in the numbers of people who are prepared to enter for Pibroch competitions. The number of boys and girls who can now play Pibroch to the standard whereby they can enter for a competition is very, very encouraging indeed.
How would you account for the enormous rise of interest in Pibroch in North America and in Commonwealth countries?
In North America and the Commonwealth countries, I think there always was a great residual interest in Pibroch. The Highland communities in these countries were very flourishing indeed, and I think maintained their own identity unaided to an extent which that we're just beginning to realize now. Many excellent pipers emigrated to America, to Canada, New Zealand, Australia, and the people they taught are in many cases first generation American or Commonwealth citizens. And I don't think the art was ever lost to any to great extent, perhaps not as greatly as it was here. I think there's always been this residual ability there, which is now coming to the fore, largely as a result of the many excellent summer schools which have been run by some of our leading performers who go over every summer and teach in America. And they have some very good pupils indeed.
One such is Jack Lee, a trainee accountant from Vancouver. It was his grandfather, a piper himself, who encouraged him. At 23, Jack has won the gold medal at Inverness, playing the Pibroch of Donald Dhu. Jack attributes his success and that of other North Americans to practicing their butts off, implying that the natives don't do enough of it. Having won a gold this year, he's eligible next year to compete in the senior or clasp competitions against the very top players like Pipe Major Angus MacDonald. Angus is setting off to try to wipe out the memory of his fifth place at Dunvegan. Now number two at the Army School of Piping at Edinburgh Castle, he's a seasoned competitor. He won the gold medal at Oban as long ago as 1963. 17 of the 91 entrants in the senior competitions at Inverness are foreigners. Among them is Bill Livingston, who's flying in specially from Canada. As a lawyer in Toronto, he's dedicated to Pibroch and to winning competitions. He gets pleasure, he says, from playing a good tune to his cat, but needs the intensity of competition for his best performances.
Maximum ultimate preparation is the thing. I'm astonished that many pipers show for a major competition and are not adequately prepared. And it's akin to taking an exam. You just wouldn't dream of sitting an examination without being adequately prepared. And that's what I try to do, and I think that's what all the successful pipers try to do, prepare very, very hard. Pibroch has survived almost solely and entirely because of the competition system. And it's hard to imagine playing Pibroch at a real intense level of performance without the added element of competition. You know, there seems almost always to have to be some letting of blood, that it be some pleasure in it.
Is quite a busy competition for me. I have children competing the same day that I'm playing in a class competition. I've got to try and make sure that I don't miss my turn.
Now standing within earshot of one of your rivals in the competition, doesn't that make you feel a bit nervous? Why aren't you further away or practicing? Or...
No, as a matter of fact, as soon as he's just about finished tuning, I'm going to slide in and hear his tune. He's a good player.
People who compete at anything must go through the same sort of agonies. With Pibroch, they seem magnified. The Pibroch world is small, close-knit, intense.
Well, I was quite happy. I got through the tune, the pipe went well, so I'll just need to wait and see what the adjudicators think there.
What was the tune? Was the tune the one that you wanted?
It was the one I wanted, yes. I played the Right of the Lowland Captain, so I was delighted with it.
Personally satisfied with how it went?
Yes, I couldn't have played it much better. Whether I got a prize or not, it's as good as I could have played it.
Ian McFadyen came second. The winner was Bill Livingston. Normally, Inverness is reckoned the top competition. Here today, though, at Falkirk, the Highland Society of London is celebrating the bicentenary of the first Pibroch competition. As in 1781, 13 pipers will compete.
Falkirk, we decided that we would set middle-of-the-road tunes so that everyone would have the same chance. Whether it was the occasion that made people tense and nervous, or whether it was the fact that the prize money was so high, I couldn't really say. But there was a tension that went throughout the competition. There was only one piper, in my opinion, who was free of tension. In all other performances, you could detect this note of worry, of tension, of stress, which is foreign to Pibroch music. It's meant to be a relaxed, Hebridean, Highland,
How'd you get on?
I broke it down, please.
How?
Just tension.
After his win at Inverness, Bill Livingston must be a strong favourite here. That seems to make him more nervous, not less. He decides to keep his pipe going on the way from dressing room to platform. That'll help ease the change of atmosphere that affects the reeds. But he's left the cover off his bag, and that's against the rules. The reason he's done it is the bag's new and easier to keep in place without its cover. The judges seem to be saying that spotting that is the committee's job, not theirs.
Well, the instrument is a very complicated one. It's the only instrument in which four reeds are blown at the same time. And like all mouth-blown instruments, they're very sensitive to condensation. And a very slight change in temperature, moving from one room to the other, will alter the tuning so that the piper has to tune up all over again. And by and large, the judges go along with this within reason. We understand the problem that the competitor's facing, and nobody wants to rush him to the extent that he's going to play badly as a result.
big prizes perhaps have aggravated the tension. £250 here for the winner compared with 60 at Inverness. There's the feeling too that you must do well this time, as you won't be around for the next one. Will Pibroch, Scotland's unique contribution to the folk culture of the world, survive that long? The threat of extinction that inspired the first competition 200 years ago has been replaced by, as some see it, an equal threat, popularity. How will the closed world of Pibroch cope with that?
Pipe Major Angus MacDonald of Scotland.